Chief of Navy, distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen. It's a great honor to be here, and it's a great honor to come to Sydney again and be in this magnificent location. Canberra does not match it, as all of you will know, from Australia at least. My subject today is really to look at why Australia is not a maritime nation. Self-evidently, all of you in this audience are from the Marine Service. We're all mariners. You embody a proud and distinguished naval service. The difficulty we face is that our country does not have a maritime tradition. And therefore, my thesis this morning is this is what will be the most serious obstacle for us to engage in Asia and in the Asian maritime region over the next 20, 30, even 40 years. So what I'm going to do in the time I have is look at the past, the present, and the future, and make a few suggestions of what we might be able to do to improve our prospects, at least from the maritime sense of maritime consciousness. One of the interesting things about Australia is that really to try and understand it, you have to understand it's a set of paradoxes. There is a very famous book by Jean Mackenzie, an English writer, who came to Australia in the 1960s, and she said, the only way you can understand Australia if you're an outsider is by understanding that it is a set of paradoxes. And some of you will intuit this. We have an abundance of physical space, but we have the psychology of coastal confinement because most of the continent is, as you know, desert. We idealize the bush, but we have the reality that we are the largest urbanized country in the world. Suburbanism is our way of life. Our materialism is well known. Our standard of living is high. It often comes before metaphysics, which is, of course, the art of living. So Australians are well known for being materialists. That's not a criticism, it's an observation. This is a well-off country. And of course, we are united by the Anzac mythology, but we are actually divided over what we think our national defense should, in fact, aspire to. The greatest paradox of all is that we lack maritime identity. We are, geopolitically, a classic trade-dependent maritime state. Our interests are tied to the offshore and oceanic geostrategic region. And that definition was given to us by Saul Cohen way back in the 1960s, and it still holds today. It is a classic geopolitical definition. So we are an island continent without a maritime identity. Not a naval identity, we have that, and we've had that for many years, but the broader maritime identity is missing. So in many ways, Australia does not belong to the great Anglo-American tradition of maritime history. We belong to what I would call the ideology of the fatal shore, the idea that we came here and that although the coastal rimland of our country is welcoming, if you go beyond a certain point, you go into the heartland, which is made up of desert and scrub. So therefore, attempts at dominion navalism, and it's an interesting thing, with this country began its defense journey attempting to build a large and powerful navy. That was replaced by the events of World War I, and since then, of course, we've had the Anzac martial tradition. That was not the way we began, but it is the way we developed. The price of paradox, I think, is a condition of strategic adolescence. That may strike some of you as a rather controversial statement, but I hope to prove that, or at least make a good stick at proving it. We have a national culture which impedes maritime consciousness. I think that's a very serious thing. A coastal lifestyle is not synonymous with oceanic consciousness. Our culture is strongly continental. Our strategic thinking tends to be inimical to a mature appreciation of the sea. All of this will not be overcome easily in the 21st century, but it has to be overcome in some way if we are to prosper. Why does maritime strategy matter? Well, as you will all know, it is essentially systemic in nature. It is fundamentally about the integration of all elements and partnerships, military, commercial, and institutional. That is why it's important. It involves that vital economic component, not just navies, but the economic component of a trading nation. And as Admiral Mullen put it a few years ago, one of the tasks is to rid ourselves of this idea that it's all about naval battles. There is more to a maritime tradition than winning naval battles, albeit that's important if you're in the naval service, but there's more to it, and I think that impedes our ability to reach out to the nation when we talk about naval battles all the time. So as a nation without an oceanic consciousness, it's a real challenge for us. And I'm not the first to identify this. There are three quotations on that slide from H.C. Allen, who was an American, who was rather surprised that Australia had a very poor maritime tradition. James Byrd, who wrote a very good book on seaport gateways in the 1960s, who said that Australia was a maritime nation but didn't know it. And of course, Kim Beazley, our former Minister of Defence, who made the emphatic statement that we were not a maritime nation in the late 1980s. So I'm not the first to make these views. So in the rest of the time I have, I want to really look at three snapshots. Look at maritime dependence and its adverse impact on our strategy. Look at the influence of national culture and impeding that ethos. And look at some of the prospects very briefly as a snapshot and where we might be going in the 21st century, particularly in the global circumstances we face. So looking at maritime dependence, I think one of the major problems for Australia is that between 1788 and 1901, we were in fact guarded by the world's greatest seaborne empire, the British. We did not have to have a maritime identity. It was provided for us. And we were able, therefore, to settle this great island continent as a new Britannia. But we were able to cultivate a culture, a paradoxical culture, which was non-Britannic, which actually could ignore the sea, if you like, a Maori incognitum. So we have a history of maritime thought in Australia. It's rather like the history of snakes in Ireland. There are no snakes in Ireland. I'm not talking about naval thought. That's a different ballgame altogether. I'm talking now about the broader corpus of maritime thinking, which in fact I think is missing from much of Australia's history. If you look at Federation era defence, the first time we actually looked at defence as a national project was at Federation. And because of our small size in terms of population, we had to do defense, if you like, in and of empire. And we took, at that period, a lesson from Mahan. And Mahan, as the quotation on the slide suggests, said to us, look, you need to look at both the local but also the global, and the global will be more important to you. So the Mahanian view was one of the views that predominated in 1901. The meta-narrative of Australia from Federation onwards was the Deaconite settlement. This great economic and social compact which was made with the nation in the first decade of Federation, and it gave us a particular kind of country, a country of government authority, a belief in egalitarianism, protection, dependence on the British and later the Americans, and above all for many, many years, a dislike of our geographical location, a fear of Asia. And we conceived of defence as a fortress defence, as part of that great British Empire spanning the globe. So we went from sharks to dingoes. This is an interesting... if you look at the early years of Federation, Dominion navalism was the original strategic creed of the Commonwealth of Australia, not Anzac warfare. The paradox was, until 1915, Charles Bean, who we all look upon now as the architect of Anzac, in fact, was a naval advocate. He proclaimed that Australians were the blood of sea peoples. He wrote a book called Flagships 3, which is a celebration of the Australian Navy. Bean turned his literary skills to Anzac in 1915, and the rest is history. He came to define that martial ethos essentially in terms of soldiers. So you find that RAN capability drops in the 1920s, and by the 1940s, we're more or less dependent on first Britain and then America. The other issue which shattered our defense, despite Anzac being this great national mythology, we've never agreed on defense. The key debates were the conscription debates of 1916, 17, and also later of 1942, where we could not agree on who should serve and where they should serve. And that has impeded our defense ever since. It severed the political bond between the duty of bearing arms and the rights of citizenship. So the paradox is we developed a martial history based on soldiers without experience of self-defense until very, very much later in the 20th century. So the legacy is a voluntary military tradition associated mainly with soldiers. So our strategic culture lacks both oceanic consciousness and a consensus on defense. And if you doubt this, just look at the debates on the Iraq War between 2004 and 2007, where the two major political parties splintered on that very issue. We've been pro-war, I guess, an anti-conscription country, as Paul Kelly puts it. It's a unique mixture. And we've not had an idea of defense being a single national project. So as John Hirst puts it, defense has been the empty core of Australian nationhood. We don't define ourselves by our service in arms, at least not the nation. Volunteers do it for us. The second major theme that runs through Australian history is the power of visual continentalism, which has given us a culture of maritime indifference. There's a great paradox. Seaborne security is what we rely upon for our economic welfare. But in fact, we have an inward-looking literary and artistic culture. So if you look at any of the explorers and the writers and the poets who've defined the Australian character, from Leichhardt through Nolan to Lawson and Patterson, they all create a cult of landscape. And it's nicely captured by Joseph Furphy in his book Such Is Life, which is a wonderful book about the Riverina and about rural workers in the Riverina. But he says, exalt the bush above the spurious and blue-molded civilization of the littoral. There is, in fact, a dislike of an oceanic a consciousness. If you look at Geoffrey Searle's famous book, From Desert, the Prophets Come, which is the major seminal study of Australian culture, if you go to the index and look for sea, ocean, and maritime, you will find nothing. I mean, literally nothing. There is zero in this book about anything to do. Even the maritime poets are not covered. It's really quite extraordinary. Another major figure in explaining Australians to themselves was, ironically, an Englishman, D.H. Lawrence, the famous author, whose book, Kangaroo, is a major study. I would recommend to anybody who's a non-Australian, the two books you should read if you want to understand Australia are Kangaroo and Gene Mackenzie's book, The Australian Paradox. You can read 30 history books and you will not understand this country, but read those two books and you probably will understand it. In this case, writers are often better than historians and scholars. As Inglis Moore puts it, the land has been what really powerfully shapes Australia. It gives us heroes and myths. And D.H. Lawrence described this as being a withheld self, an inability to come to terms with actual environment, by which he meant really the environment of Asia more than anything else. So the world's largest island possesses a deep inwardness drawn from landscape. It's a very interesting paradox. One of the most extreme groups that existed in Australia between the 1930s and the 1950s and still exists in the literary world today, it was the Jindiwarabeks. It's a literary movement, but it had strong political overtones. And they dismissed the sea. And one of their poets was by a guy called Ian Moody, some of you may have studied him at school, who said that we should dismiss the blindness of ship-fed seas from colder waters. They were strongly of the view that we should embrace the Aboriginal culture, that we should embrace our continental landscape and celebrate this as a true Australian way. In many ways, they were ahead of many of the trends. If you look at the work of Les Murray today, it's very much in the Jindiwarabak tradition. So where does this Australia go in the 21st century? What is the maritime ethos? Will there be one? I don't know whether we will actually discover that maritime gene in the future. But I do know this, the Australia of 2015 is very different from the Australia of 1915, and in the future it will be different again. If you look at what happened to this country between 1985 and 2010, we see the overthrow of the Deaconite settlement, which was really the fundamental building block of this country's development in the 20th century. That has gone in favor of a socioeconomic reform movement involving globalization and free markets. That's been a very, very powerful movement, very, very disruptive, but it's also given us a lot of prosperity. If you look at where we've been since 1985, the economy's tripled in size since 1985, tripled. That's extraordinary. Our GDP's gone up by 182%. We are in the G20. We have the seventh most developed economy in the world. The dollar in 2008 was the sixth most traded currency. Our demography is changing rapidly. In 2010-11, the Chinese overtook British migrants or British residents as the main source of permanent residents, many of whom were business residents. So our economic transformation is underpinned really by freedom of the maritime commons. We could not have any of this prosperity if the maritime commons was not, fixed for us. So what are the strategic transformations, the implications of a rising Asia? I think the economic power shift to Asia will make Australia a strategic anchor adjacent to that Indo-Pacific arc, as many speakers have pointed out in the last couple of days. And those statistics on there are borne out by what I've heard in the last couple of days. 30% of world trade goes through the South China Sea, 66% of oil through the Indo-Pacific. And if you look at the way a global seaborne trade will double over the next 20 years, and energy will increase by well over 50%. So we're in the right part of the world for economic development. But we have to be alliance focused, we need to be globally sensitive, we need to be regionally orientated. And we need to craft a maritime approach or a strategy that meets our Asian economic future. That's the single biggest challenge which is facing our military and political establishment. And the question is, boom or bust? And this is a really serious question for the country. Australia's prosperity is fueled by the Asian economies. And if you look at the 2012 Asian White Paper, the Australia in the Asian Century, it has no maritime focus, which is a really strange omission. But it does contain one striking phrase. It talks about the tyranny of distance being replaced by the prospects of proximity. The problem we have here is that historically, the prospects of proximity have always been outweighed by what you might call the perils of proximity. And certainly our defense policy has long, reflected that coloration. So we are poised in 2015, I would argue, between past and future. And it's unclear if the prospects of proximity will be seized. If you look at what has happened over the last 10 years, we have a political system which has really had difficulties. There's been a crisis in our political leadership, 5 prime ministers in 5 years, not exactly an indicator of political stability, and faltering economic competitiveness. The country has to overcome mass debt, a decline of responsive government, and above all, a trivial culture of political policy, public policy. Our public policy has become trivial, dominated by Twitter and the media space. So we have a choice of futures that faces us. A forward maritime-focused Greater Australia, or a repackaged Australian settlement that seeks past comforts. And that there are people on both sides of politics, in both the Liberal National Coalition and the Labor Party, who would like to go back to that Australian settlement, where there is protection, where it is comfy, where it is relaxed and comfortable. The smarter heads know we have to go forward, and that will be painful because it will involve change and tax reform and so forth. So the challenge is to reimagine the country for the new century. And reimagining the country has already begun. There's a very interesting study by Asher Judah called The Australian Century. It was a very upbeat study, which argues that we need to reconceptualize the country as an archipelago of population islands, not as a continent. Now again, this is not a new idea, the idea that we have archipelagic population centers. He argues that Australia gives a great impression of being a continental nation, but in fact is really a very efficiently organized and arable archipelago, and I think he's right. We have those 5 very, very powerful population centers, Sydney, Melbourne, Brisbane, Perth, and Adelaide. And they represent an archipelagic urban aorta, generating 65% of our economic activity. So in the future, this is how we need to reconceptualize the country. And we need to look outward. The future engines of our prosperity require vision. We must exploit the economic rise of a cosmopolitan middle class, especially in Asia. By 2030, the global middle class, on current trends, will number 4.9 billion, tripling from today's number of 1.8 billion in 2015. Now, that demand will be fueled by urbanization, energy, and the demand for education. So we need to invest in Australia in political vision, expert educational sector, a larger skilled immigration program, tax reform, and competitive labor market attuned to exports to the global middle class. These are all, of course, political questions beyond us in this audience, but they are questions which will decide whether we go forward as the 12th largest economy in the world, or whether we slip down the rankings to 17th, as some people foresee over the next 15 years, and actually drop out of the G20 by 2035. So looking outwards, we need, I think, it would greatly help us if we had a supporting maritime narrative. The narrative has to explain the surrounding seas as highways to a prosperous future, not as moat defenses to vanished ages. That period has gone in our history, and we need to look ahead. I like what Brett Biddington said in his Kokoda paper at the end of last year. He said the most important outstanding task is for a narrative to be developed that explains the importance of the safety and security of Australia's maritime domains in the nation's broader national security and economic well-being. These matters have not been well articulated to the broader public. And that's a true fact. So really, I'd argue we probably could do three things. We could probably do three things within defense or within the what you might call the academic military studies community. The first is a conversation with the country. And here I should acknowledge the work of Justin Jones when he was head of the Seapower Center. There was a great program in the Seapower Center a couple of years ago, about pushing a maritime school of thought into Australian industry, business, and into the academic community. And that's something we need to take even higher. We need to have a conversation with the country, strategic communications and an educational strategy. We also need a well-funded National Institute for Maritime Affairs, a NEMA. Now, I know that there are some fine organizations, the University of Tasmania, Wollongong, and the Australian Naval Institute, all do great work. But I really think to focus on the geopolitical nexus between economics, national security, and maritime awareness, we need something bigger, well-funded, and which has a really national profile. And I'd offer that as a possible way forward. The other thing we need, and we could do this in the ADF, and it's long overdue, we need a doctrine, concepts, and development center at the joint level above the single service centers. The single service centers do fine work, but the work tends to be at the tactical operational level because that's the way they're configured. You need something at the strategic level, and I think a British-style DC-DC would be a wonderful investment, and we would get a lot of return from it if it was set up right, if it was headed by the right kind of one-star or even a two-star officer. But it would take the issues beyond single service, and I think that's important, even though the single services would feed into that organization. So those are just three rather modest suggestions. What is the logic of a maritime consciousness? Well, I always like to use what Willie Sutton said, the great bank robber. He said, why do you rob banks? Because that's where the money is. Why do we need a maritime consciousness in Australia? Because that's where the prosperity is. It's nowhere else. You're not going to find this in some mine in the middle of the Pilbara. The stuff has to be exported. It has to go overseas if it's going to be converted into money. So that's a simple narrative we need to develop. It may seem simplistic, but that's probably where we need to go. So some conclusions. We have a lack of maritime consciousness. It's a striking paradox in this country's history. We somehow need to refocus our national culture to enhance the economic oceanic awareness. I'm not suggesting for a second we should turn our back on ANZAC. That's not the point. The point is ANZAC is not adequate to take us where we're going. It's a wonderful national tradition, but it is not going to take us into an Asian century, into an Asian prosperity. We need to think and reconceive where we go. I mean, we should be able to hold two traditions in our head at the same time, a military martial tradition and a maritime tradition. That's what most countries are able to do. It won't be easy. It is a generational task requiring leadership and vision. But to ensure our future prosperity and the prosperity of our sons and daughters and grandchildren, this has to be done. I'm convinced a maritime narrative must be developed if we are to maximize our economic and social progress in the future. We must become seasickers. We must overcome the legacy of the fatal shore. I think Australia is at the dawn, not the noon of its destiny. But all destinies have to be seized. A rendezvous with history must be seized. The future awaits us, but we have to seize that future. It will not simply wait for us. It will move away unless we seize it. We have to overcome what A.D. Hope, the great poet, said about Australians. He said we were secondhand Europeans, pullulating timidly on the edge of alien shores, that famous poem, Australia. We have to become the bold visionaries of Roderick Quinn's famous maritime poem, which gets very little air nowadays, called The Sea Seekers, where he has a group of young men and women riding down to the sea. And when they encounter the ocean, they shout to the morning seas for the joy of it, realizing that's where the destiny of the country lies. So that's where we need to go. And I might stop there and hand over to Admiral Goldrick.
Mike, in some ways, is a hard act to follow, but in other ways, I think an extraordinarily good and easy one. because in talking of the future of sea power, many of the problems which Mike has raised in relation to the Australian consciousness and the way in which Australia as a nation state deals with the sea are in fact problems increasingly shared globally and for a number of reasons. And I do mean increasingly shared globally. I spent the first 6 months of this year in the United Kingdom. I have to tell you, as somebody who has been back and forth from that country since I was a child, I have now seen what was a maritime nation turn into one that has no maritime outlook at all. Not by comparison with where it comes from, or actually where it is and where it should be. If we're talking about the future of sea power, we have to understand that we're talking about problems of the globe and problems of how we all exist. Because sea power is about how the sea is used. And that's the first point I want to make. We are talking about the use of the sea in all its forms and in all its ways. It's not just about navies. It is, as Mike has positioned us, it's about the existence of nation states and their prosperity. The second brings me to my point about sea power is that the nation state is not the only actor, but nation states critically determine how the sea is used. Now, I'm going to make some observations about where I think the use of the sea is going, but I want to point to a couple of problems which I think contribute to this erosion of a maritime consciousness, even in countries which should be fundamentally maritime. The first is the creeping invisibility of maritime activity. And it is actually epitomized by the harbor in which we are in, which is almost now not a working harbor. And this has happened all over the world in that commerce has moved out of sight in its seaborne modes. We don't see the container ships going to and from Botany Bay. 100 years ago, you saw 5 or 6 ships entering Sydney Harbour every day and 5 or 6 others leaving Sydney Harbour. And the population saw that happening. The second is more subtle, and I actually blame us would-be maritime strategists in part for this. We use the wrong language. We talk of sea lines of communication. Well, I never liked that anyway. I've been at sea often enough to note that there are no lines on the sea. And we are too free with expressions like choke points when actually we should talk about capacity points, because ships can go around most blockages. There's only one global choke point, that's the Strait of Hormuz. Every other strait in the world is a capacity point in global terms. It's not a choke point. That doesn't mean it's not really important, but it does mean you've got to focus on what matters, which is the ships. But the third relates to the dynamic, the tension between the old economy and the new economy. And really, it's the sort of thing that happened with the global dot-com boom, where suddenly materials, housing, energy, transport didn't matter in the excitement over what was available through the electronic economy. The fact is, you always will need to feed and house people. You will need transport. In other words, material things matter. Well, the trouble is, when we talk about communication, if I'm looking at anybody in this room under the age of 25, communication does not relate to material stuff. It relates to instant communication via electronic means. It's the wrong word. We need to focus on talking about ships and using the sea and moving stuff around. But I do think there is a problem, and Mike, I think, has encapsulated it very well in an Australian context. It's a wider one. And it creates a naval problem. I remember a journalist who once made a comment, and she was very pro-Navy, that in the eyes of many, the Navy had become a subversive organisation which went to sea for the purposes of wasting taxpayers' money where no one could see them. That actually does reflect a wider problem. And we do need to have national efforts wider than navies to get people to understand that actually we are all sea dependent. Now, my argument today is that that dependence in a global sense will continue. The maritime domain will be essential for global economic life and for the expression and projection of national power. But we do have this challenge of increasing complexity, which will sometimes verge on chaos. I'm not a worst case person, but environmentally, in a host of other ways, we are facing a lot of challenges. There will be developing tensions between emerging international concepts of governance and sovereignty and classical ideas of freedom of the seas. Now, I want to speak in more detail on these challenges, but let me just remind you a bit about how the sea is going to be used and how it will change. In some ways, I don't think it will change. I think we are still, even we're in a post-colonial era, we are still seeing a continuation of a process which has been evolving since the beginning of what is now termed the era of Vasco da Gama. And if the first era of globalization was based upon the triple expansion engine and the ocean-going steam cargo vessel and the telegraph, the second comes from a combination of the container and the internet. The first era allowed the creation of just-in-time economies in relation to food and raw materials. The second has allowed the further refinement of the just-in-time boundaries in relation to those cargoes, but also supporting the development of an unprecedented level of the distributed manufacture of components integrated with central assembly. That's the big difference between globalization then and now. It's not the internet. See how the telegraph was used in 1914? It's practically instantaneous in terms of exchange of key information. Ships provide by far the cheapest mechanism per ton mile for the long-range distribution of containers, and that cost is steadily being driven down, not just by the increasing size of container ships, and we're seeing these big liner containers ships getting bigger and bigger. One of the things it's worthwhile looking at is the reduced signature in terms of emissions that modern merchant ships have achieved by comparisons with those built 20 years ago. Well worth going and doing a look at that. The reduction in signature and therefore energy consumption has actually been quite profound. So that will continue. And that means that even with the realization, for example, of China's ambitions for the development of its own heartland, as well as Central Asia in general, and Russia with its own eastern provinces and the economic community it seeks to foster in Central Asia, the relative advantages that ships have over land transport will be sustained. Mahan, for the time being, beats Mackinder. It's not an absolute, but that advantage will be maintained. What will change will be the patterns of growth and the trade routes of greatest growth. My assessment is that the Trans-Pacific and East Asia-Europe shipping levels will stabilise with only moderate long-term growth. What will increase significantly, and this is of course of particular interest to many of us in this room, will be with the development of the Asian middle class, will be the movement of trade around Asia, particularly between India, China and ASEAN, as well as the energy and resource flows into Asia. Now, I'll add that there is an emerging tension about that cheapness, and that's the cost of the facilities required for the very big cargo ships, as well as the physical limitations on the ports and harbours which they can enter. The hub and spoke concept has its logic, with feeder ships taking cargoes to smaller ports. But I think there's going to be some interesting disruptive effects if smaller ships can manage to reduce their own costs through innovative technology, particularly in wind and solar propulsion. The future of global fisheries is less clear. Now, we need to think about fisheries. Navies always have had to think about fisheries. I will say I get very impatient with the expression non-traditional. Sorry, Nelson was in the Fishery Protection Squadron. I've done it in three parts of the world. Wars have been fought over fisheries by navies. And fisheries are a central global question. And if, as naval officers, you don't understand how global fisheries work, you'd better start thinking about it. Because the extent of global overfishing and the potential implications of the general collapse of many key fish stocks is, in my opinion, yet to be fully acknowledged, and there will be some consequences to be worked out. There are local and even regional success stories in environmental management. I think the Baltic is one in particular, and sustainable exploitation. But there are many more of uncontrolled and devastating damage, and many of those are in our region. There can be no doubt that the inability of many developing states to manage their own maritime zones combines with a lack of proper governance of much of the high seas. This represents a fundamental problem for the world as a whole and a threat to regional and global stability. Climate change and environmental degradation, ironically, often something much more the result of human action on land than at sea, and in Australia we had the Great Barrier Reef as an example, only worsen the prospect. The need for collective action on fisheries and maritime environmental management thus remains urgent. And indeed, the nature of that progress, based on consensus and then commitment on the part of many nations, suggests that continuing to drive for collective action has to be the priority. We saw, for instance, Sea Shepherd doing for at last something useful in chasing an illegal fishing vessel to its ultimate scuttling in the South Atlantic. But the real reason it scuttled was that finally we'd had sufficient systematic port control regime enforcement that illegal fishing vessel had nowhere to go to unload its cargo. In other words, it was what was happening on shore that mattered as much as at sea. More capable nations need to redouble their efforts to help build capacity in poorer states and provide it with due recognition to sovereignty when the challenge is beyond the reasonable power of a small country. There will always be the need to have the sensitivity to the questions of sovereignty involved, but we do have to do more. Now, it's problems such as these mean that the future maritime domain will, in many ways, be a theatre for a contest between control and licence, between the historical experience of the sea as a global commons with very few restrictions on its users, and those which did exist came into being almost always by consensus, and its evolution into a much more regulated environment, much more akin to the situation in the air and on the land. My personal view is that we have to move to this much more regulated environment. If we don't hang together, most assuredly, we're going to hang separately. But creating this level of assured and secure awareness that will be required to make the world's oceans a governed regime is going to be much more of a challenge than many realise. And here we have another, I think, failure of educating people to understand just what the maritime domain is. Too many commentators, and in this country many who should know better, think of the sea as some sort of totally transparent space, absolutely apparent to the observer. It's what I call the Google Earth effect. The failure so far to locate the wreckage of the tragic Malaysian Airlines Flight 38370 has been just one demonstration of the lack of consistent surveillance over many areas. But the truth is that even in the narrow seas and the littorals, where distances are much shorter, being able to know what is going on has a level of difficulty much more akin to that which is encountered in contested urban environments. We actually have much more in common with the police chief in a city in which there is considerable crime than we do with the owner of the desert. Hence the difficulties encountered by so many nations in their own zones, even those in which the strength of the national flesh matches that of the national spirit. Most of the data sources for what passes for awareness in fact rely on reports by beacons or other mechanisms. In other words, what we know is based on omission and compliance. But there is already evidence that many of the data sets of things like automatic identification system are being deliberately corrupted by commercial interests or criminal gangs. Similar problems have long been experienced with equivalent vessel monitoring systems, which fishing vessels are required to operate as a condition of their licenses to work within other nations' exclusive economic zones. Fiddling with your input is pretty common. Furthermore, much destructive activity in the maritime domain comes from what could be termed the sea-focused grey economies of developing nations, in small, not always, but often primitive craft, or in larger vessels which have the most basic of equipment. And I think Admiral Doan made a good point with the scale of these sort of activities by pointing out that there are about 240,000 vessels in Indian waters which do this work. Fundamentally, their effective management needs the equivalent of the policeman on the beat, not just the eye in the sky or the remote sensor picking up on the beacon or the emission. It also requires close cooperation between authorities at sea and those in harbour. Now, there is a counterpoint to this business of greater governance, an attention that is apparent in some of what is going on at sea at the moment. Nations face many challenges in how they manage the drive towards greater control of what happens at sea in ways that don't surrender to a form of creeping sovereignty. Some of this creep, and I think I implied it in what I've already said, has justification, but only some. And I want to dwell a little on the subject of offshore facilities, whether for oil and gas drilling or for activities such as wind power. And we haven't yet seen in Australia the extent of the growth of the offshore wind industry in the way that it has, for example, in Europe. Such assets need to be protected. And I think it is clear, particularly from some of the debates going on about wind power on land, that we're going to see even more fixed facilities out at sea to generate energy. It's fair to say that land-based ideas of fixed asset security do and should be applied to them. But no artificial facility, however large, however costly, and however important for its owner, generates sovereignty in its own right or should be allowed to. Placing platforms or wind turbines cannot be an excuse to close off sea areas, and the need to protect their security must not be allowed to interfere with the freedom of legitimate commercial and subsistence activities, or indeed of the operation of naval forces. And this is a tension. Let me now talk in military terms. Let me endorse what I think our colleague from the People's Liberation Army Navy, a point made about anti-access area denial. In a sense, it's nothing new. Coastal defence has always been an imperative of a nation state which has a coast. The fort and the ship have always been in competition. But the range at which things are happening is a change. Anti-access area denial, in order to achieve that range, fundamentally depends upon the achievement of a sufficient level of awareness, both in terms of time and precision and location, to render approaching naval forces so vulnerable to attack that they cannot achieve their missions without suffering acceptable losses. in principle, it's the same thing as the fortifications on either side of Sydney Heads. The gun doesn't allow an enemy ship through into the harbour. There can be no doubt, I think, that emerging A2AD systems represent a serious threat to naval forces. But it's much less clear whether they represent an existential one. First of all, A2AD systems are instruments for high-intensity warfare, while naval forces, with or without their amphibious elements, have utility across the spectrum of conflict. The classical military, diplomatic, and constabulary roles of navies will remain to be fulfilled. And as I've said, they're just going to get more complex. But even in high-intensity conflicts, the correlation of forces is extraordinarily difficult to predict and will remain so. I know that trying to gain some idea of what may happen is probably the major preoccupation of naval planners and wargamers in more than one continent. The difficulty for both sides is that A2AD and maritime operations are both, in their modern forms, highly dependent upon networks for command and control, surveillance and targeting. Any high-intensity conflict is going to see these networks becoming targets in their own right, and the disruption and resultant unavailability of communications networks and remote sensor and intelligence feeds may well become the rule rather than the exception. Surface and seaborne air force operations and tactics will evolve and are evolving in ways that will focus much more on covert, deceptive, in-and-out deployments and strikes to an extent that has not been seen conceptually since the height of the Cold War, when Allied navies sought to subvert the Soviet ocean surveillance system and the Americans were working on the maritime strategy. The situation of A2AD operators may well become analogous to that of the sniper in trench warfare, looking for the exposed head or limb across no man's land while trying desperately hard not to become the subject of attack yourself. Mobile forces, surface naval forces, on the other hand, and air forces, and subsurface forces, to continue the analogy, may well operate much more on the same lines as trench raiders, attempting to remain covert, to achieve surprise, to create a deception and a distraction, and to strike a hard blow and retire before the defence can respond. As I mentioned with the maritime strategy, in fact, what we're seeing is arguably, in a different technological context, a return to some of the concepts current at the end of the Cold War. What is clear to me is that major surface combatants and amphibious forces are not going out of fashion. Indeed, there is a new drive to greater size in terms of surface ships that may itself be a recognition of their utility across the spectrum. Utility based on the fundamental nature of being able to use the sea, the carrying capacity of ships which can move. In contemporary terms, this of course translates to weapons, sensors, helicopters, landing and boarding parties, and platform endurance as well as survivability. But what we're seeing is an extension to unmanned vehicles which can be deployed, recovered, serviced, and redeployed over, on, under, around, wherever you like, on land, over land. And my personal view is that such swarms, which we tend to think of in terms of coast small craft operating from the shore, but I think we need to start thinking about as operating from mobile bases on the sea, will also have the potential to provide the ships concerned with a bubble of awareness in three dimensions, and arguably in three environments, that will assist their survivability in high-intensity warfare. In a contest which involves both cyber and kinetic elements, such local networks might well prove much more robust and usable than systems which span space and the continents. Unmanned vehicles will also provide manned ships and submarines with agents of action and influence. Systems which can be deployed into the areas of highest threat, in other words, you don't need a volunteer, you can send the unmanned unit, establishing which areas are safe
even if they lack the capability to conduct engagements in their own right, and many are likely to have that level of engagement capability as well. Yes, there are real challenges with this in terms of power supplies, artificial intelligence. One can go on about it, but it does seem to me that this is the likely direction of the naval use of sea. What I do say that in military terms, for the future of navies, I see a need to ensure that we do not allow the concerns I've already mentioned about offshore facilities to become creeping territoriality and creeping sovereignty. Exclusive economic zones are economic. The exclusive refers to the economic. It doesn't refer to anything else. And I think to retain as much freedom of action will be central to the ability of navies to retain much of their utility across the spectrum of conflict. If I might comment at one point, at this point, I do genuinely believe that although China has a view on the EEZ and military operations, my belief is that the increasing capabilities of the Chinese Navy and its increasing global responsibilities and global commitments will actually evolve a different approach in order to give that Navy the capability that it wants. And let me finish with a point, because I think it is, in terms of the future of navies and the future of sea power, one of the challenges, not just for China, but for other countries with emerging capability and emerging global responsibilities and interests and global concerns, is that the great challenge of the future is how we move to a much more collective approach to the sharing of responsibility for the maintenance of that fragile system about which we've been talking of the last few days, upon which we all depend. Arguably, if the 20th century was marked by the handover of lead responsibility by the United Kingdom for the maintenance of the global system to the United States, the 21st century, I hope, will be marked by an increasing collectivization and sharing of the responsibility for the maintenance of good order across the spectrum of conflict and the preservation of the global system upon which we all depend. That, I think, is for all of us and for our countries a particular challenge. And I think that challenge will be met by a much more sophisticated recognition, not just by navies, but as I hope I've made my point clear, navies need to get more sophisticated than they have been, but by nations, national industry, national thought leaders as to how dependent on what happens at sea we are. Because sea power is about the use of the sea, and man will continue to use the sea. Thank you.
Well, ladies and gentlemen, we've just been delivered a pair of rich, thought-provoking and challenging presentations. I'm very happy now to open the floor to questions to Professor Evans and Admiral Goldrick. I think by the final day of the conference, we all know the drill. If you'd like to ask a question, please indicate that to me with a raise of a hand and we'll get a microphone to you for that.
Morning, gentlemen. Nam Yuen from HMAS Perth. I guess with that last point, Admiral, you raised, and Professor Evans, I'd welcome your thoughts on this as well. Collective defence has been easier to achieve than topics of collective security because it's more narrow in focus versus vital interests. Will it take a shock in vital interests, say a dispute over fishing regulation, in order to achieve Australians to be, you know, to resonate the anthem of being girt by sea rather than girt by beach in their minds. So I welcome your thoughts on what it would take short of active leadership in that role.
You go. Look, my understanding is that the cooperative strategy that the Americans have developed is about keeping the global commons open with like-minded navies. So that's a move towards a collective outlook. The challenge will be to bring in navies who don't always share those values. But I would submit that we all share an interest in being able to trade. So I would think that from that point of view that there is a great deal of, as Admiral Goldrick says, collectivization makes good sense. So that's what I'd offer.
I'd say that I don't want an incident so serious that it would achieve a collective change on the scale. What I do say is that there needs to be a much more active conversation by everybody on these issues, and all navies need to be talking to their national business, their national industry, their national thought leaders. And it's not a propagandist navalist approach. You know, and to an extent, a lot of what's passed for a naval conversation over the last 150 years has been navalist. This is not what I'm talking about. But if navies don't understand exactly how their economies work and don't know what the levers are and don't know who to go about which lever, then I think they're failing in the foundation of being able to execute their role. So I think the conversation has to be much more extensive. What I would say is I think the education needs to be much more extensive in what you're for and how it works. Because most people have no idea of how the global economy works, even in a basic sense. But I'm not talking navalism. I want to emphasise that, and I think Mike's presentation really made that point. This is a maritime problem.
Thank you. Jane Chan, RSI Singapore. Chair, if I may, a question for each of the speakers, please.
Please.
Professor Evans, you speak about the need to create a maritime identity. And in fact, this is a question that many other countries are thinking about as well. And it will take a very long process. So my question really is that does it require, what is the prerequisite for a nation to slowly move towards a maritime identity? Does it require a national maritime policy, so to speak, that include not only the naval and maritime aspect of it, but also to include the maritime industry and economy and tourism, etc., etc.? A question to Admiral Goldrick. Thank you for the very illuminating presentation. When you speak about sea power as the ability to use, to explore, to exploit the sea, in recent years, we hear of many maritime nations coming up with new maritime aspirations, those of China, those of Indonesia, and even India. And a lot of this, you know, has a narrative that does not has a very strong emphasis on security and strategic implication. Most of it are commercial, most of it are infrastructure. But how much of this, when we try to judge, you know, what is a modern sea power, will we need to consider that ability to defend, that strategic implication for safety and security in the region, in the world? Thank you.
Oh, thanks for that question. I think education is very important. I think national political vision is very important. I think bringing together not just the navies of the world or the navies of a navy of a country, but also the industry, the business sector, all those who have a stake in prosperity and in stability would be interested in maritime affairs. The problem we have in Australia is that we've had our culture is inward looking because we were allowed to do that because of Seapower. But we are on the cusp of a new era. For the first time, our destiny is now going to be decided in Asia, not by the Atlantic powers, but by Asia itself. And that means we'll have to look into that maritime environment. It will require a different dialogue and a different narrative. And that will be the big challenge for not just our politicians, but also for our service chiefs and our CDF in the future.
And I think Mike has in part answered that second question. It seems to me that it's actually getting this understanding that it is all interdependent. I'm not sure which country it was where the Chief of Navy was trying to get to do an ad which actually took a supermarket and then said, if supplies are stopped for a week by sea, here's what the supermarket looks like. The legend goes that the result was so terrifying that the minister concerned wasn't not happy about that exercise in maritime awareness. You know, and there is that danger, you know, as I say, no treasurer or minister of finance is going to admit what they really think about the economy. Because by admitting what they think, they may have the effects they don't want to have. Similarly, there's a great danger that you actually frighten people by showing them just how apparently fragile the system is. So that there is a balance. What I would actually say is this good historical example that actually dependence creates resilience because you actually have the ability to manage on the grand scale much more easily. That's a complex argument and I can explain to you outside, but one has to be careful to get that balance of getting understanding of the dependence, understanding of the fragility, but not being frightened about it.
Neil Jones.
Neil Jones from the Australian Defence Association. And thank you both for presentations that are music to the ears of the ADA. My question is really to both speakers. As Australia becomes a far more diverse society with a lot more people coming overseas, the ancient white European culture of the bush doesn't appear to be dissipating. In fact, if anything, my experience is it's actually getting worse, because as we diversify, most of our culturally diverse population just flocks to the urban areas and lives there, and really just reinforces the myth that we're not a maritime country. I'd be interested to hear your views on how we tackle this culturally entrenched problem in a far more diverse society where it doesn't appear to be dissipating. It appears to be getting worse, and you only have to look at the standard of political debate in Parliament to indicate that.
I don't think, Neil, it's a question of turning your back on the bush identity. That's an important part of being an Australian, and I have to say that, speaking personally, I love the Australian countryside, the landscape. One of the interesting things for me was when I started out doing this project was to go and look at Australian literature, and I developed a great love of the literature, but I just don't think in the 21st century that Anzac Bushmyth is going to be sufficient. It'll be there. It'll be part of our identity. You don't have to turn your back on it. You don't have to turn your back on an Anglo-Celtic civilization which has brought so much prosperity and so much stability to so many people. What I've suggested is that we probably need a different kind of narrative which builds on that, which says there is another maritime narrative. I mean, the Americans have both a continental myth and they also have a maritime myth. In a sense, we need a maritime narrative which complements our bush and country myth. There's nothing wrong with these two, and they should not be either ors. They should be additives. So the appeal I would make is that we really need to reconceive, because our geopolitical circumstances are going to be different over the next 50 to 60 years. So again, it's a generational task. This will be going on long after you and I are cold in our graves. So this is a task for our sons, our grandsons and granddaughters. They will be battling with this because the age of Europe is over. It's that simple. The fulcrum has moved to the Pacific, and that's where we're going to go.
And I think, Neil, I'd get back to this idea that we've actually got to have conversations. and I'm particularly conscious of it from having recently been involved in the public consultation process for the White Paper for Defence, we're not talking enough with, I think, the newer arrivals. And we have to find better ways of, you know, once you've got the narrative, and actually a lot of it's there, I think, is actually having the conversation and trying to change the perspective and the outlook. Bearing in mind, don't forget, all of, you know, we're all, apart from the First Peoples, we are a country of immigrants. People bring baggage with them. And to some extent, the conversation will need to be different depending upon where you came from. But we do need to have much more of a conversation. And if I can make a point, I think navies have happily gone off to sea far, you know, and not, remember, they're meant to explain what they're doing. But again, it's wider than that. It's maritime industry needs to do it as well. And industry which is dependent upon export and import, which is almost everybody.
Good morning, gentlemen. Ben Welfare from HMAS Watson. Harking on those two comments in terms of generating a future dialogue, a future conversation, how do you see that we get the younger generation engaged, you know, both from a social perspective and potentially even through the education system? Do you see that there's a mechanism for doing that in the next couple of years or into the next couple of decades?
I think we need to work out new ways of getting new mechanism and new ways of getting that access. I don't have sufficient expertise to be able to tell you how to do it. All I know is I know enough about having dealt with millennium generation to know we do have to change. But I don't know how.
Yeah, it's a big challenge. It's a screen generation. It's a generation which effectively doesn't read. It's a real problem when you look at images. At some point, that generation would learn that wisdom does not come from information, but from knowledge, and knowledge is distilled from information. At some point, they will learn that, probably when they're in their 30s. But how you engage them, my experience, like James's, is limited. But I've found that they're very screen orientated. They Google everything. It's for someone like me who was brought up with the classical education, it's a very bizarre way of living. However, I have a daughter of 21, 22 who lives like this. So I have some sort of domestic experience of the situation. But how you extrapolate all this in terms of the education system, I'm not sure. That would require a study within itself.
What I will say, and I can, in fact, I was having a conversation yesterday, there's a very interesting group called SimSec in the United States, basically led by a group of young naval officers. It has international membership, some of which is in this room, and is very much, you know, the cycle is much faster, and most of their stuff and most of their exchange is actually pretty good. So I suspect that's the sort of mechanism. Mind you, you know, the people in their late 20s or mid-20s who are running that are sort of dinosaurs in one sense, so probably we should go and ask the 15-year-olds what they, you know, how to do it.
Good morning. Sam Ferrelli from the Department of Defence, to both Professor Evans and to Admiral Goldrick. And I might be being slightly provocative here, perhaps. To what degree would you say that Australia's defence strategy actually supports, reinforces, and to a degree justifies the continentalist cultural approach that Professor Evans spoke of? We talk about a maritime strategy, but it is a maritime strategy where we define it at all. It's defensive in nature. We continue to focus strategically on the so-called air-sea gap. And by focusing on the so-called air-sea gap, it's almost as if we reinforce this vision of the ocean as a moat rather than a highway. Do you agree with that? And if so, how do we change that?
First off, just to remind you that concept was actually constructed at a time when there were political imperatives which actually threatened Australia's defence capability on ideological grounds. Post-Vietnam, left-wing of Labor. It provided a construct which actually gave you a serious level of capability, and to those who originally constructed, to be fair to them, it was based on a different level of defence spending than actually happened. So it's important not to be too critical when that was what was politically acceptable. Do I think that hanging on to it too much can be a problem? Yes. And yes, it does reinforce fundamentally a half, it's only half the story. Various people in this room will know that I've had a long debate with Professor Hugh White about the fact that you will still need to move fuel around, even if you're doing that purely defensive, largely airstrike, you know, air power focused thing. So it is to me only half the story. Provided it's one element, and you know, there's a logic to be able to do that, provided it's one element of the whole and seen that way, then I think it's quite appropriate. But as I say, it's really important to understand where it came from and not to reject what happened then and why that happened then.
Yeah, I think political economy is one of the least understood aspects of Australia's defence policy. The impact of political economy on spending. You know, I've been a critic of the Defence of Australia strategy. I now believe it was a product of its time and place. It doesn't mean to say I agree with it. I think it retarded our ability to do a proper maritime strategy. In fact, if you go back to the 1940s, if you look at the 1946 Chiefs of Staff Strategic Appreciation, which they did after the Southwest Pacific Campaign, it actually outlines more or less the strategy that we're adopting today. What happened between the 1940s and today, or rather the last 15 years, has been really the Cold War, forward defense, a whole lot of other issues, and then DOA, of course. So do I think DOA was good for a maritime strategy? No, it was a denial strategy, in my opinion. And it in fact, rendered the Army into, as Angus Campbell said yesterday, a wooden gun, to quote Menzies. We effectively had two services, not three, as we had the gendarmerie running around the north. So if you're to have an effective maritime strategy, you have to have all three services involved. Who's going to do the amphibious? So, you know, we've since moved over the last 15 years. We have moved away. I mean, we have used the term maritime strategy in a proper sense since 2000, and we're slowly moving towards it. So I'm quite optimistic that we will see the error of our past ways, and I use error in a conditional sense because, as James has said, there were political and financial reasons why we adopted that particular approach.
Commander Blackburn.
Guy Blackburn, Canberra. I've sort of danced around the subject. The military at the moment is leading the attempts to try and establish a national maritime consciousness. We've just had the TPP released, free trade agreements seem to be coming into vogue. Everybody understands the globalised economy, and we're a highly consumerist society. 6% in manufacturing now. Undersea cables, we rely on that for exchange of information. So I'm wondering if, whilst the military is leading it at the moment, I don't see anybody from foreign affairs, I don't see anybody from Treasury here. Why aren't we looking to other instruments of national power to try and lead this conversation for establishing a maritime consciousness, noting that at the moment we seem to be pushing the effort with limited success.
I agree, it's the success so far has not been what I would have liked. We have to keep at it. I do think we're dealing with a symptom of the problem of having an artificial inland capital, which is too separated from the majority of commercial and industrial activity. But we have to keep working at it, and I think, in fact, we've got to understand what are actually the centres of gravity, and they may not be in Canberra. You know, are we talking enough to business and industry, which is Sydney, Melbourne, Perth, and increasingly Brisbane, you know, and the north? Are we having those conversations? Are we getting those people to talk? Just as I would very much hope that there are very strenuous conversations going on between southern China exporting industries and the People's Liberation Army Navy about their concerns over trade. So there's a mutual understanding. It may be that, you know, yes, foreign affairs should be here, trade should be here, all those others should be here, and we have to keep trying to get them in the tent, but I'm not sure they're the centre of gravity for this conversation.
Look, as I flagged in my presentation, I think one of the answers is a National Institute for Maritime Affairs, situated not in Canberra. Let's make sure it's in Sydney or Melbourne or even Perth, but let's make sure it's somewhere near the sea. And it has a strong economic and business focus, has a series of fellows. You could take fellows from DFAT, you could take fellows from all over the place. It has essentially what you might call a whole of government approach and focuses on the broadness of maritime. So that's a challenge in itself. We'd have to find funding, we'd have to find people to run it.
I understand there may be a question on this side. Ma'am.
Connie Buckley from Indonesia. I try to hold my questions, but I cannot stand it. My question to you, Mike, is, in my opinion, Australia have all the capacity to become a maritime nation. Because when I see outside and all the things that you do, you can do it. My question to you, is it because that you relied too much on UK before, and then now you become the part of the biggest alliance of United States, that make you hesitate or make this country hesitate to be independent as a maritime nation? That is my question to you. To Admiral, you are emphasizing on economic and the importance of the Navy to understand economic. Perhaps you forgot something, that economic growth by or move by the energy. If you see the energy security tools by the United States, the 1, 2, and 3 is stated about the another alternative of energy. But number 4 is stated the United States built the Navy to get and protect the oil and energy from around the world. And number 5, to get that energy to strategic petroleum reserve. The question is, everything about the United States is always sexy. If that country with energy security tools followed by China, or perhaps soon followed by Indonesia, what do you think about it? Because there's another problem of energy things. The International Energy Agency is controlling countries to have energy power. Example is my country. Actually, this energy perhaps will reduce the intention of Navy to go abroad if then any other country can have the multi-purpose reactor. Thank you so much.
Thanks for that question, Connie. Look, Australia was founded as a fragment of Anglo-Celtic civilization out here in the Asia Pacific. It's not surprising that we should have clung to the great Atlantic civilizations from which we came. It's not surprising at all. I actually think that that's been a good thing for us in the sense that it's given us Western democracy, it's given us liberal values, it's given us a parliamentary system. The downside for us has been, you're quite right, we lack an independent spirit in terms of strategy. And that's because we've never had the population or demography to do it on our own. That will change in the years to come. By 2060, this country will have 45 million people. Now, if 45 million people can't run an independent strategy, then there's something seriously wrong. And we will probably have 25, 26 million people by 2025. So we're getting there. It's taking time, though. What I do think is needed, we need to invest much more greatly in Asian languages, in Asian history, and all the things which are important to our trading future and our economic future. It's no secret, our grasp of Indonesian society has declined over the last 20 years. It's quite remarkable. So that needs to be looked at. And I'd suggest that needs to be done as a national project.
One of the interesting developments of the recent years is, of course, in terms of energy, is that the United States' actual direct dependence on energy flows from the Middle East has reduced to almost nothing. And of course, arguably, I think in order, the most dependent countries relatively are now South Korea, Japan, and China on what comes out of the Strait of Hormuz. And I think what that indicates is that while the United States, of course, has wider issues about regional stability, that energy is simply a component of the whole global system. it's perhaps the key, you know, it's the absolute essential one, the keystone with, if you pull that out, the whole thing collapses. But it's a component. And I think that the collective effort needs to be focusing on the whole range of human activity. And by the way, and we know, I have talked navies, I think the evolution of coast guards and maritime security agencies is but another recognition of the multiple dimensions of this problem. But it's not just navies, maritime securities and other government agencies, it's also international organisations and indeed international commerce.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for your questions. And also, if I could ask you to thank, to join me in thanking Professor Evans and Admiral Goldrick for their splendid presentations and thoughtful and illustrative answers to your questions. Obviously, they've generated a great deal of interest amongst the audience. So, gentlemen, thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, it's now my pleasure to offer the podium to Vice Admiral Tim Barrett, the Chief of Navy, to make closing remarks at this, the end of the Seapower Conference 2015. Sir.
Distinguished guests, ladies and gentlemen, I start with an observation. The first question that was asked at the Seapower Conference this year was by Neil James, who asked us whether we really understood the maritime culture, and not just us in this room, but did Australians and further afield really understand, and what were we doing about it? And I would posit that we've just sat through two excellent presentations that have really still asked the same question, but have provided some direction or some statement of what can and should be done. There are still challenges for us to be able to look at how that is done. We in the room might understand the role that the Seapower Conference plays is to educate ourselves, but more importantly, and as we have heard, to take that knowledge forward and educate others, and that is the challenge. I'll make one example. I recently spoke at the Australian Ship Owners Association meeting in Melbourne. It was held in the Melbourne Football Stadium, but we only needed a very small room in which to hold the meeting. The number of people involved in the commercial shipping industry within Australia was very small. It is our role still to speak to them, to speak to government, to speak to commerce, to speak beyond just those who may build naval ships, to consider the maritime industry beyond just that which is naval, to pass the very messages that have been challenged over the last couple of days and so eloquently put in the first question and in the presentations that we've heard today. My task now, though, is to close this, the ninth Seapower Conference, and to thank all of those who have made it possible, and my counterparts and their representatives for being part of what we have we have been together over the last 3 days. Look, I would like to start by thanking Captain Mike MacArthur and his team from the Seapower Centre for putting all of this together. Could I also make a special thanks to The Voice, Lieutenant Commander Desmond Woods, who has held your attention for the last couple of days in bringing you into this, into the conference. The quality of the presentations that have been delivered by our speakers, I think, has been remarkable, and I thank you all. You've contributed your experience, you've contributed your knowledge and your wisdom and your collective understanding of all the things that we needed to discuss as part of this conference. I'd also like to thank the media who have reported these proceedings, which again is part of what we have just discussed. It is important that what is debated and discussed and learned does not remain within these four walls and this rather tenuous ceiling we've got here. It needs to be in the public arena. A swift reminder of the scale and the breadth of what we have been considering, I think will be useful and instructive, so just bear with me. We've covered a lot of ground. At the opening session on Tuesday, my fellow service chiefs, that was Angus Campbell and Leo Davies, provided the perspectives which remind us all that sometimes one service leads an operation, it is in fact our interdependence that continues to build on how we deliver on that operation. We each depend on the specialist skills of the other two services and the whole of government approach which gives us our ADF operational capability. I remind you all, excuse me, the service chiefs all play for the same team. We all carry Australia on our shoulder flashes here regardless of the uniform that we are in. We have heard of new perspectives on the growing significance of resources in the Indian Ocean. We've heard of the importance of maintaining transparency, of strategic partnership, and of obstacles to interoperability. We've been reminded of the absolute requirement for access to advanced power and energy systems if intelligent decisions and intelligent decision making is indeed to be possible. We've heard of the impact of new technologies, of the vulnerabilities of petroleum supplies, and we've been reminded of those issues pertaining to transnational maritime crime and terrorism that still remain major threats to us. We've had to consider the evolution of the Australian maritime consciousness, while at the same time great power competition re-emerges. These speakers have ranged far and wide and collectively have provided us with the results of their experience and their scholarship. Papers will be produced by the Seapower Centre in due course. But can I ask all of us in this room to thank all the speakers that have prepared us, put us where we are today in this 3 days of conference. Thank you all. From the Australian perspective, and I guess from the Chief of Navy's perspective, the future of Seapower will be shaped now by the rise of continuous shipbuilding, which will enable the Navy and the Australian nation, and it's important we understand that this is a national imperative, not just a naval imperative, but it'll allow the nation to participate in global affairs in ways which are not yet fully understood. It is a strategy which will generate unanticipated potential, and thus it will enable the Navy to deal more capably with uncertain futures. But before I close the conference formally, I would like to provide a final take-home message that I think resonates with us all, and it's this. Nations build navies on the foundations of ideals and in response to political necessities. There may be challenges along the way, as we've heard, particularly in the presentations just a few minutes ago, but Seapower is established as a force for good on the face of the globe. It is established in partnership with industry, and in the Australian case, in partnership with the Army and the Royal Australian Air Force. In the quest for Seapower, navies would be foolish indeed to think that they can do it alone. Indeed, it's not only our responsibility. And we would be wise to foster the collaboration and the interdependence of which we have spoken frequently about at this event. The future will be challenging. The roles we play will be different. But they will overlap. As nations committed to justice, we will seek to advance good order at sea, and we will be informed by what we have learned over the past 3 days. And with that, I now formally declare the conference closed. Thank you all.